Amen. There is a word tonight from the Lord. And it's found in the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians. Let us pray. God, our Father, we're so grateful tonight for another opportunity to stand behind this sacred desk. Now, Lord, we ask for a special anointing that your word may go forth with power, with might. Lord, move me out of me. That your people see all of you and absolutely none of me. Because it's not about me anyway, it's all about you. Give us listening ears that we might hear what the Spirit says to the church. It's in the name of Jesus, the only name that matters, that we pray and ask it all. Amen. In this 13th chapter of the book of 1 Corinthians, beginning at the first verse, you will find these words. If I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that I can remove mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor, surrender my body to be burned, and have not love, I am nothing. Love is patient and it's kind. It does not envy, does not boast, is not proud, is not rude, does not seek itself, is not easily angered, keeps no record of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes. And I asked you last night to really look at verse 7 when you had your time with the Lord today. Some Bibles say something different. One version says, love always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. This chapter, 1 Corinthians, is commonly known as the love chapter. How many of you know that that's something we can never talk enough about? I often wonder why Paul took an entire chapter in the Bible to discuss the supremacy of love. I believe it was because love is the foundation of all who are Christians in the household of faith. This chapter teaches us, church, that if we are to be like Jesus Christ, if we are to walk in his footsteps, then we've got to love like he loved. We must love others with a love that is pure and it has unselfish motives. Do I have a witness? It is my opinion that many talk about this noun, this verb, but they don't really know what it means. They don't know the real sacrifices love calls for. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. That's a powerful statement. And some might even call it foolish. That's the reason I want to share with you tonight from the thought. Love makes you do foolish things. Love makes you do foolish things. Some years ago, a group by the name of Martha Reeves and the Vandettes. Y'all say that, y'all know that. They recorded a song entitled Love Makes You Do Foolish Things. For those in here tonight who are under 50, the song talks about all of the irrational things that a person in love might do. Things like sitting alone by a telephone in their rooms, waiting for that lover to knock on the door, knowing they're not going to show up, unable to eat, unable to sleep because you're so much in love, holding a picture frame. And it reminded me of the foolish things I did as a youngster in the name of love. Most of us in here, we know what it's like to be in love with somebody, or at least we used to know. We might not want to admit, but a whole lot of us, we've done some foolish things in the name of love. Things that we might not want folk to know about. As a teenager, I was in love with Stanley. Stanley was tall, tan, good looking. And when he did come to my house, my daddy told him, you can't come back here to see my daughter. Because you're too old for her. My heart was broken. Why did daddy have to embarrass me like that? Didn't he know I was in love with Shane? I did say I was foolish, didn't I? Well, a few months ago, I performed my cousin's wedding ceremony. And Stanley was there. Hadn't seen Stanley in over 35 years. The Stanley I saw was not the same set. He was no longer tall, upright, and good looking. He was not the same one from back in the day. But then he was bent over. Probably had a total of 6 teeth in his mouth. And they were all over the place. Love me, and I don't have decent clothes to put on, and you got a closet full, but fourth verse to give us some characteristics of this agape love. He says love is patient. Love is kind. When you have the love of God embedded in your heart, it will give you patience you never knew you had. You will find yourself not allowing folks to pluck your nerves nearly as much as they used to. When you got the God kind of love in your heart, you'll find yourself being kind to folks that one time you couldn't even stand. You'll find yourself speaking to folks you vowed you'd never speak to again. People won't understand it. And perhaps they'll call you foolish. But this kind of love, when you get it like you ought to have it, it will make you do foolish things. Paul continues by saying that love does not envy. But it's happy when good fortune happens to others.
That's right.
If there's one thing that will destroy us quicker than anything else, it's jealousy. Jealousy has destroyed many nations. It has ruined many friendships and relationships. Caused chaos in the workplace. Caused dissension in the church. For whatever reason, y'all, humans find it difficult to rejoice when others do well. It seems to be our nature to do our best to destroy them. But the quickest way for you to get your blessing is to praise God when He blesses others. Once you have the kind of love Paul is talking about in this scripture, you won't have time to worry about what others have because you'll be too busy counting the blessings God has given you. I'm reminded of a story of a woman who was a member of a church in my area. Her house burned down. She lost everything she had. The family had to depend on Red Cross, handouts, whatever they could to survive. Her friends and relatives, they were crying with her because of her hardship. But then all of a sudden, Pastor Tucker, the Lord began to bless. The insurance policy paid off. She was able to build a brand new house, which made the old one look like a shack. She bought and paid for all new furniture directly from the factory. After the house was completed, she invited her friends and those who she helped her, who helped her rather, when she was down. She wanted them to come and see her blessings. Do you know some of those friends got mad with her? They stopped speaking to her. The point of the story is folk will cry with you when things are going bad. But at the same time, they're hoping that you're going to stay in the right that you need. They refuse to rejoice with you when things go well. But the Bible clearly tells us to rejoice with them that do rejoice and weep with them that do weep. To those folk who don't have the love of God dwelling on the inside, to rejoice with others might seem foolish. But if He abides in you, love will make you do foolish things. I like verse 7. That's the one I told y'all to concentrate on. It says love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. In other words, no matter what they do to you, you are commanded by the word of God to love them. No matter how much they lie on you, assassinate your character, you got to love them. No matter how many times they mistreat you, God says you got to love them. When others are ready to fight, you are commanded to show love. Yes, my brothers and sisters, love will make you do foolish things. But that is what agape love is all about. You see, God is not coming again to fulfill His will. That's what you and I are here for. We are His ambassadors. He has no hands but our hands. No feet but our feet. We are His representatives. The question is tonight, what kind of representative are you? Are you displaying the kind of love God would have you display? Or do you only love those folk who love you in return? Do you turn the other cheek? Are you ready to cuss somebody out and fight at the drop of a hat? Do you love folks in spite of themselves? Or do you only love those whom you perceive as good people? To love God and to love others, it might seem foolish. But again, love, it'll make you do foolish things. Before I conclude this message, allow me just a few minutes to look at some personalities in the scripture. Some might call them foolish, enough to put their life on the line and put their hand on life, rather, totally in the hands of God. They will prove my point tonight, that love will make you do foolish things. How about David? The Bible declares that he was a man after God's own heart.
That's right.
David loved God with all of his being. He never worried about danger because he knew that God was always there to protect him. David did the unthinkable. He went up against a giant with five smooth stones and a slingshot. I heard him say in Psalms 23, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because thou art with me. David said, I don't have to worry about those giants because I've got goodness on one side. I got mercy on the other side. And they're going to follow me all the days of my life. If David were here tonight, he would tell us that the love of God will make you do foolish things. Hello, Daniel. There were those who called Daniel foolish because he loved God so much that he prayed three times a day. Even when he was told not to pray to any other God but the king, he ignored that command. Daniel went home and he opened his window to Jerusalem. He called on the name of God three times every day. Darius ordered Daniel thrown in the lion's den. It looked like there was no hope, but Daniel's testimony was, my God is able. Some would say that Daniel was foolish, but I believe if he were here tonight, Daniel would tell us the love of God that'll make you do foolish things. But there was one more person I have to tell you about before I take my seat. You see, he's a special man in my life. When I tell you his story, many of you might call him foolish. You see, one day, he looked at the condition of the highest creation he made. And he said, I've got to redeem him. I've got to pay the price for his sins. Perhaps the angel said, Lord, that's foolish. Why don't you just start over and make a brand new man? But he said, no, that won't do. I'm going to send my beloved son down there. And he can pay the price for the sins of mankind. The cherubims cried out, but this is your only begotten son. Why don't you allow him to die for a world of ungrateful individuals? I can hear the answer that came back, because I love them. And love makes you do foolish things. Jesus came to this earth, y'all. He walked it for 33 years doing good deeds. Many of the persons he helped, they were the ones who turned their backs on him. Some would call that foolish.
those folk who hurt you, who mistreated you, who did awful things to you. I'm a living witness. I've been through it. Had lawsuits against me, filed by my best friend, supposedly. But love makes me do foolish things. I can forgive that person. I can forgive all those who don't mean things to me. Because God loved me so much. I'm thankful tonight for the love of Jesus Christ. God loves us in spite of ourselves. And He wants us to have that same love one for another. If you can't love your brothers and sisters, you're in trouble. If you can't be kind to folk in the church, out of the church, you're in trouble. Won't you stand to your feet tonight?